Welcome to an educational video by SnowGeek.org. Visit our website at SnowGeek.org to find more information or visit our YouTube channel and subscribe to our Twitter. In this video, we'll be talking about how to do a stability assessment when you're given the data, and let's dive right into it. So here, if you're not familiar with how this plot is set up, we have temperature here in degrees C on this scale. Then we have hardnesses here going from impenetrable, knife, pencil, one finger, forefinger, and fist. In this blue, this is the hardness profile, so this correlates to the different hardnesses. It tells us how hard is the snowpack at these different layers. And this red line is the temperature, which correlates to this. So the snowpack ranges from -9°C to -4° at the bottom. Then in this column, we have the type of snow it is. So in this case, we have surface hoar. Here we have near surface facets. We have melt freeze here. Then these are facets with some rounds. Melt freeze again. And this is mixed facets and rounds. The difference between this one and this one being that this has more facets, annotated by this. And then we have melt freeze at the bottom. And the last piece of information we can get from here, not the last one, we have the size of the grain. So 4 millimeter surface hoar, 1 millimeter, 1 millimeter, 2 millimeter. And it's not reported for these because melt freeze grains don't really, the size is not well defined because they're melt freeze grains. Then we can see here that we have two stability tests were performed, a compression test and a propagation saw test. The compression test is when you have a 30 by 30 centimeter column, so something similar to this, and it's isolated on all sides, and then you put your shovel on top of here, then you tap it until you get a failure. And a propagation saw test is when you have a 1 meter block cut backwards, so up into the hill, so you have something like this, and you identify that the weak layer is perhaps right here, and then you run the blunt side of a saw coming from here, and you run it backwards until a failure is initiated. So looking at the snowpack just in first glance, I can see that what I'm really going to look for is there a slab somewhere? Is there somewhere that has denser snow on top of not so dense snow? And looking for weak layer. And immediately I can see that, yes, we have something right here. So this is a pretty thin slab, but it's still a slab sitting on top of a less cohesive layer. And not to add, this is less cohesive and it's a persistent grain type. It's a classic type of instability. So here I can already see that we've identified our primary concern. There's something else down here. We have melt freeze on top of mixed facets and rounds, but we're more interested in this because it's closer to the surface, so easier to trigger. And if we have a problem, this will be a problem before this becomes a problem. So now to go to our stability assessment. To do our stability assessment, we draw our stability wheel, which has four components. So we have our trigger, propagation, and slip likelihood, the probability that it triggers, and then it propagates, and then it slips. And then at the center we have how many structural weaknesses we have. So let's begin with our structural weaknesses. So we have the first one, which is, so these are the five lemons, and we can add a sixth one at the end. So these are, is the weak layer within 1 meter? It is. It's right here at 35 centimeters. Is it a persistent grain type? It is. Is the weak layer less than 10 centimeters? We do not have that one. Is there a difference in grain size that's greater than 1 millimeter? So we have 1 millimeter here, and then the grain type size is not well defined, so we usually count that as yes. Because right here we're looking for contrast. Similarly, we are also looking for the contrast of hardness step between the slab and the weak layer. Is it greater than one step? It is. So that's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So 4 of 5, and then the one that's commonly added in Canada, which we'll add here, is there a difference in hardness between the bed surface, so this, and the weak layer? And there is. So another one. So we have 5 of 6 lemons, and usually 1 to 2, that is kind of like a low. 3 is moderate, and moderate really means I need more information. And 4 to 6 is high, and that's, we really do have a concern. So we're sitting inside this region where we are really concerned. So now we look at our data. We have a compression test, which had a hard result, which means it failed on the top 21 to 30. So here we have a low trigger likelihood. Propagation, we see that they perform a propagation saw test, and if it propagates any time at 50 or before, then that is propagation. So we do have a high probability of propagation. And finally, we look at slip, so we can see that the result was Q3. So we'll report that it's low, but we need to note that this is the stability assessment at 26 degrees, because we see that the slope here was at 26 degrees. So if we plan on skiing a slope of 26 degrees, then this applies, and we're pretty good because it's not likely to trigger, not likely to slip. But say we went to a slope of 40 degrees, that may not be the case, because although this and this stay constant with a difference in slope change, this most definitely does not. And typically goes up by at least 1, if not 2 steps for every 10 degrees of slope steepness that you have. So if you plan on skiing something at 40 degrees, then you really should do a stability test that's closer to that range. So looking at this, I can see that if we ski low angle, then we're pretty good. If we go to steeper, we have to be very careful, because although it's difficult to trigger, if we manage to trigger it, it will propagate, and we still really don't have a good idea of how this varies with slope angle. So on a day like this, I might test a steeper slope, but in reality, this, the fact that we have a very weak snowpack and that there's high propagation, means that the snowpack is not structurally sound, and if something does happen, it's going to be large because it's high propagation. So on a day like this, it would be good to be doing tree skiing below 35 degrees. So here we can see that we have basically taken a look at what this is telling us, then what type of grains there are, which ones they were, took a look at our tests, and then created a stability assessment out of it. If you want to watch more videos like these, visit snowgeek.org and keep tuned for more. Subscribe to our YouTube and follow our Twitter account, and of course, visit our website at snowgeek.org.